Okay, good evening. Thank you for coming. Okay. Alright. I'm just going to start tonight with just a few updates about where we're at with things. We're moving ahead with the neighbourhood plan. I'm away for 3 weeks, and when I get back, I'll be writing to everyone who's on the email list, and we'll be forming an initial group, which is we'll also be linking up with Pokestown Forum, so we can get our 21 names together, get an idea of who's on and what skill sets they've got. I've been talking to quite a lot of people over the last few months, and we'll establish the area, which is most likely going to be Boscombe East and West, just the electoral boundaries, and then we'll. What happens next is then you set up the, you register the forum as a neighbourhood forum, an official one with locality, and then we can apply for the funding to do the engagements. And then we've got about 12 months to 18 months of hard work. But out of it all, we'll make a big difference to Boscombe. So if anyone is still interested in getting on board, now that hasn't given us an email, if they could give us an email address at the end and I'll add you to the list. And I'll keep you updated regularly as we progress through it as well. I've been talking to the Echo, so they'll be featuring it as a serial feature, the progress of it, because I know a number of other forums in Bournemouth are interested as well in how we get on. The other day we had a regular monthly meeting with council officers with the communications framework meeting, which we set up at the beginning of the year, and we're slowly working our way through the six, what we call the six pillars of the regeneration effort. And the next forum we're going to be pretty much definitely tackling health, and we'll be having Sam Crow from the council coming along, who's in charge of health, and someone from Public Health England coming along, and I'll get some more details out once we firm that up at our next month's meeting. I think that's well for the updates. Oh, there is one other one. There's a Portland 2026 approach to me, their approach to put together a community economic plan. So I went to Bristol with them, and it was quite interesting. There was a lot of community groups there. It was about got about 60 community groups working on economic plans, and they're community economic plans, so they're about local small businesses, cooperative efforts, community cafes, things like that. But the Bournemouth 2026 are going to arrange a consultation, so anyone who's particularly interested in that, I'd encourage them to get along. I think I'm going to be away, and I haven't heard from Tina with a date. She was saying about the 21st, 22nd of July, but I've not heard from her. So I'll try and chase that up tomorrow morning, but make sure we get the word out. But it's really the initial consultation just to discuss what kind of expertise that needs to come down. And there's a choice of four different agencies, and you get two of them to come down and give their expertise to help build the plan. And then they apply for some funds to do the engagements. So I will keep you informed about that. Tonight we've got Matt Chutter, Deputy Inspector. He was going to be Inspector, etc., but Matt stepped in. And the last meeting, we were listening to the crime stats, and someone asked, we were told that the overall crime stats are down, but someone asked what crimes are up, and there was a bit of a gasp through the room when it was revealed that the violence against a person stats were up 30% over the last year. So, because obviously we've got a lot of comments about that, we've asked the inspector to come along and give us some more detail and understanding into that. So I'll pass you over to Matt Chutney.
Okay, thank you very much for inviting me. Sadly, Mr. Setchell, who was the inspector of last time, was not available to speak to you tonight. So we'll try and improve on that continuity next time. I'll just give you a little bit of flavour around some context around our current figures, okay? I'm going to be as candid as I can about it, because I think it's important that you know currently the state of play in your community. So, as Dorset Police at the moment, we're currently in a transitionary period between two computer systems. We used to have something called Force White system, and now we're going on to a new system called Niche. Niche is a very progressive system. It gives officers a lot of autonomy around recording crime. It gives people a lot more confidence in crime recording. It also integrates a number of other systems that we had that were previously standalone. So those that are IT aware may know. But the bottom line is we had a selection of different systems that all talk to each other, but not in the correct way. And it was difficult to actually then send that information to other agencies. But now we've actually got this new system where it's all integrated. Okay? Obviously, you can understand with that there's an enormous amount of training that's required with that system. Okay, so what I need to tell you now, at the moment currently, is because we're in this transitionary period, and we've been running that for approximately 8 weeks now, our data that we're currently getting out of that system can't be relied on, all right? It's not as accurate as we need it to be. So what I don't want to do is stand here and give you unreliable data around that. Okay, but what I can do is give you some positives around the previous, prior to the 8 weeks that we've been with Niche. So I can give you some of the older statistics, although they are actually currently 8 weeks out of date. Okay, so I'll give you those first, and then I'm going to tell you what we're going to do to progress that in the future. So the positives are, prior to Niche coming in, when we could check our data, our positive outcome rate was 29.2%. Okay, so what that means is we're just under detecting, so that means charging someone, getting a positive outcome, community resolution or a cannabis warning, something positive for the members of public, we were getting just below one in three crimes we were detecting, which I thought was really good. We had a reduction in the number of repeat victims. Our antisocial behaviour reduction was 25.3%, which is in comparison to the year before. Our robbery reduction was 78.6%, and our dwelling burglary reduced by 34%. These are exceptionally good figures. Now, I'm going to tell you what the negatives are, and I'm going to say they're called challenges, right, for us. And they were our theft from unattended motor vehicle. That's when people break into your car and steal your sat nav or anything like that. There was a sharp increase, okay, in your area. Now, we did a tremendous amount of work using covert assets, that means hidden assets, and obviously high visibility patrol, and we've got on top of that. And that was linked very much in with a series of hotel breaks in a similar area. We got on top of that, arrested approximately between 8 to 10 people, they've been charged, taken offences into consideration, and both of those series have now stopped. Now, the thing that Harry was talking about earlier was that domestic and non-domestic violent crime increased in your area, all right, by 29.2%. And that was in comparison to the year before. Assault with injury, that's when you get injured, maybe a cut, or maybe a small broken bone or something like that. And common assault were the most commonly reported offences. And you'll be surprised to hear that actually encompassed in that, included in that, is harassment. Now, harassment almost doubled. All right, now I just want to put some context to that for you, is that since the advent of social media, harassment has increased along with that as well. So some people use social media to actually harass others. We make ethical decisions around that and we record it as a crime. So that's included in those figures. All right, so that needs to put a bit of context around that. So at the top we have assault with injury, that's our highest repetitive crime, then it's common assault, then it's harassment. Okay, now you want probably some answers around that, why violent crime has gone up. Now, at the moment, I've drawn conclusions, and this is just from me, that the increases in these areas, in these crime areas, are down to better officer training. Okay, you would expect me to say that. But actually our officers are better trained than they ever have been in identifying crime, recording crime, making good ethical decisions around crime. So we believe the victim, okay? And that's what the victims are saying to us. They want to be believed, so we are believing the victims, and that's why we're making these good ethical decisions. And I strongly believe that that's why our crime rates can go up, I have no doubt. People do have, and we've got some stats here, stats aren't everything, I get that, but actually, people that were surveyed said they had 84% satisfaction with Dorset Police as a whole experience in your area, okay? So I'm just drawing on that conclusion that actually people have got more confidence in the police, 84% at least, who report stuff, and they want to actually report it to us because they know we'll do a good job with it. Right. Also, there was an increase of 48.3% in domestic violence crime with assaults, common assault and harassment being the top three within domestic related violence. Okay, the majority of these offences are actually committed behind closed doors. So, it's a difficult one for the police because actually what happens behind closed doors is very difficult for us to intervene until we actually get called to it. Obviously, when we do get called to it, deal with it very, very robustly. We've got a positive, a way of actually dealing with it very robustly and positively when it comes to domestic abuse. And therefore, sadly, our preventative work is a little bit limited on that. But obviously, when we do get called, we deal with it robustly. Right. Obviously, the last year as a whole, we also saw a significant rise in violent crime, both nationally and within Dorset itself. So I just want to impress upon everyone here, this rise, being very dramatic, is not standalone to Boscombe. Okay, the majority of other sections within our force and nationally, I'm sure the PCC will come on to that later, you're not alone. Okay, it's a dramatic rise. Okay, but it is mirrored with other forces and it is mirrored throughout the country, all right? So, what I'll say to you now is I've looked at the new analysis that's coming through, okay, and some of the old analysis, and there clearly are hotspots within your area. And hotspots are where there are frequent recurring crimes of a similar type, okay? So, what I intend to do is as soon as our new data machine is back online, I'm going to commission new statistical or analytical work to increase our understanding of this current problem profile we've got around the rise in violent crime. Okay, once I've got a good understanding of that, then I will put in place a problem profile with the intention of trying to reduce that and get it back to show that we can get it back to a manageable amount. I mean, the good news about it is that actually I've identified those hotspots through the ambulance school work, and then we've actually got special constables. We now have 7 voluntary special constables that are attached to Boscombe who will be, once that ambulance school work's done, will be deployed to try and combat that violent crime. Okay? And I think just one more important thing to talk to you about is currently 31% of all violent offences that occur on your area are alcohol related. Okay, so that's just under 1 in 3 are alcohol related. Just to make you aware of that, okay? Obviously, if it transpires that with a new analysis of that, then we can work with responsible licensing. I know there's some good work going on in the other end of the county of Weymouth around some of their factors that are going on. We can learn lessons from that and apply it. But at the moment, without that analytical work, I'm not going to make any firm decisions on that. Okay? So obviously I need to form that opinion first, get the facts behind it, and then act on it.
Is there a national
figure for that? Sorry, no, I haven't got those figures. I mean, I can find out, hopefully, then I can feed it back to you through the next meeting. Or if that's too long, we can try and feed it back sooner through the councillors, if you wish. Sorry, I haven't got access to them.
What's the limit for drug-related
violence?
If there's
a
limit
for
drug-related
violence?
Alcohol is a drug.
It's the
biggest drug.
If we can just take questions one at a time. Yeah. Are you ready to answer questions? Finish first?
No, that's absolutely fine. No, I've said all I need to say.
Okay, I'll take this question first, though.
Sorry.
30% for drug-related violence as opposed to alcohol-related violence?
No, sorry, I haven't got those. I think once the data analysis comes online, then we will be able to get that, because actually once someone is a victim of crime, for example, or an offender of crime, then there is a special flag that goes onto the system to show us that it's a drug-related offence. So those figures could be available. If it was useful, then I'm going to feed it back to you.
I think it would be quite a useful thing for Gloucester particularly. So question.
And then last June, this June, somebody tried to force themselves into my house twice in 1 year. Could you also tell me the knife crime? That has gone up today. That's been reported on BBC this evening about the knife crime as well. Could you tell me how many people have been killed in Boscombe in the last year?
Right, obviously, yeah, I did see the BBC today on the website and on TV saying there's been an increase of, I think it was 14% in knife crime. There was an intention that if people got caught twice with a knife, then there should be a custodial sentence applied. I haven't got the figures available for knife crime in Boscombe. However, that could be available in the future if you need it. If you want me to feed it back to you, absolutely. And sorry, what's the other question?
How many people have been killed in Boscombe?
Is it in Boscombe at East?
Boscombe
General. Obviously, I've got to think about that very carefully. In that, I cover the whole of Bournemouth East, and not just Boscombe. So there are other areas, including Pokes down south, or Springbourne. Yes, I believe it's two.
Okay. I think one of the statistics was there's been a decrease in the amount of people who feel safe going outside after dark, from 33% down to 21%, so only 1 in 5 people surveyed, just figures from Chris Weeks, coming out, not feeling safe after dark, so 1 in 5 people in Boscombe.
Can I just ask how many people here were actually asked that question?
I wasn't asked. Right, who here was actually asked that question? I think it's done through their surveys, but I think when I was at the business forum yesterday, there was one of the problems we have in Boscombe is that the precincts got a lot better in the daytime, so you've got these CSAS officers that got a presence by the TARDIS thing, but after 6 o'clock, it seems to all vanish, and a lot of the businesses have commented, particularly ones that are open later, and I know I get a lot of comments from customers that come and see to where I am. They get a lot more antisocial behaviour comes out after dark. I mean, what can we do about that as a community? I mean, it's not a great thing that, you know, for especially for a place that has tourists coming to it, that we have a situation like that. And moving forward, how would we tackle that?
Yeah, well, all I can say is around Dorset Police, we obviously work on something called a demand profile. Now, obviously, we work out how many calls we get for a certain area or a certain amount of time, and then we direct our resources to that area if there's a specified problem. I mean, locally, if you've got an issue around, say, for example, the precinct after 6 o'clock at night, people are fighting to come out, or who haven't been canvassed, as you pointed out. Yeah, if people haven't been canvassed, the right people, then obviously that's an issue. But if you've got a problem, I think the best thing to do is obviously talk through the councillors, but obviously you can come straight to Alan or I about that, or the SNT. We've got two sergeants who work the SNT, and that's Ash White and Colin Neath. They're always open to talk to you. They're on the telephone, and or you can email them direct and let them know what the problems are. And then we will assist with our partners. It's got to be a partnership approach. Obviously we're looking at shopkeepers, licensing, and any other agencies that we can speak to come up with a solution for that. So if there's a clearly identifiable problem, we can assist in sorting that out.
So is it that you need people in the community to phone stuff through with 101 or something like that, so you've got that on the register, or is it just turn up and say something? I mean, if you base your policing on a provable need, I presume you need an official call, people phoning SUD?
We use that for analysis, yes. But now, obviously, at the moment, I've just spoken to you about our unreliable data currently, or data that we can't rely on. But obviously, I think, yes, you need to ring and let us know. There are other ways of, you know, letting us know. You can email in. We've got various SNT inboxes. okay, that are available on the internet. You can go directly, and then you're assured of a response from the person that picks that up. We do have special safe neighbourhood officers that cover each of the areas, including Boscombe, and we do have police community support officers that do cover that area, and they do monitor their inboxes daily. So you have got an issue, either email or 101. Now, I know there are some issues which the police team can cover about 101, but obviously, please bear with it.
And is there something
we do need to know so we can...
Anti-social behaviour books as well, I've heard about, is it where they, people are getting a specific problem, can they get a kind of an incident book where they keep a log of everything?
Yes, they can, yeah. Anti-social behaviour diary.
Yeah.
Okay, for a specific individual, if you're being targeted, then you can have a diary, fill it in, and give it back to the safer neighbourhood team that covers your area. And then we will make a multi-agency approach to dealing with your problem.
Could we, as a forum, could you send us a list of what people can do in order to let you know what's going on and get hold of these books and things like that, and then we can put it on the website with the minutes, just so that people can put it through the social media.
Yeah, absolutely.
That'd be great.
Yeah, I've got the process of that, and we will update our current safe neighbourhood officers because we've got a little change around to meet demand.
Hi. I realise you want to sort of be able to get plans and routines, but my personal observation is that when something's happening in Boscombe, i.e. a big event at the BIC, at the O2-ing, or a football match, or some such public event, as it were, there's plenty of police. But as a resident, on a day-to-day basis, what I see with the police, apart from, yes, you do get two police officers or police and community support officers wandering about in the daytime, what I observe with the police is they're going somewhere. They're not here, they're going somewhere. You know, you've got blue lights, you're rushing into town or wherever. I realise budgets are stretched, but I'm sure I would be supported in saying, could we just not have more random patrols? Why do we have to provide evidence of crime? It's obvious that we need more patrols on a random basis at all times of day and night.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like I was talking about demand profile. Obviously, we do quite a bit of analytical work to see where our hotspots are, where our call demand is. And sadly, and a lot of times, you know, belittle it, but actually the days of having a police officer just standing on a corner for sort of reassurance is gone. We have to really look at our core business. We look at our stuff around threat, risk and harm, okay? Yeah, cool.
Have you done quite a lot of on-call work in another area, emergency area? When we're on standby, we're available. When your officers are not actually in response to an incident, could they not be on standby looking? Could they not be parked up? So that we knew where there was, not guaranteed, but there was regularly a police car parked at that spot, so we knew if we needed to run or if we needed to shout, there was a fair chance there'd be a police car there, as an example.
Yeah, I suppose what you're trying to say is very similar to the ambulance service. They wait at their various junctions. Sadly, we haven't got that availability at the moment. The officers, we've only got a finite amount of officers, and actually they are committed almost 100% of the day now. To allow that to happen, I know our plan's in place, because of this new niche system I was talking about earlier, the officers now are being handed out sort of laptops / palm tops. So that means if you are a victim of crime, they could come around your home address and do all the work there. So there's no point going back to the station. They will be deployable almost 100% of the time. And they can do all their work on those palm tops. You may have seen it on some police programs. And we're almost at that position now that these assets are going to be deployed. So that will free up some of the officers' time. So they won't be going to and from the station to do their paperwork. They can do their paperwork out on the ground, which obviously gives them better coverage for you. But sadly, like I was going to reiterate, we can't go back to the days of cops being in areas that nothing happens, for example, on a just-in-case basis.
But what about kind of prevention? You're talking about responding to crime, I'm talking about preventing crime.
Yeah. we have police community support officers to actually show, you know, a high visibility patrol. However, they are really committed as well because they have their day-to-day jobs as well dealing with neighbour disputes, so they are committed with that. But we do deploy them as much as we can, and that's why we have a footprint at the police box right in the centre of Boston.
That's a daytime thing though, isn't it, Ian?
Yes, it is, yeah.
So I'll just pass it.
I've got learning difficulties, but I'm just going to say this, and it's going to seem minor compared to other people. But point number one, the TARDIS police box you've got, we mentioned 4 o'clock today as police going to be coming to this meeting tonight, and the lady had absolutely no idea the police officer or PCO, whatever she was. So could that be passed through if you're going to be at these meetings again, so the residents, if they go to the police box, know if you're going to be here? And point number two, which is probably maybe not your responsibility, are we going to be seeing any more SPIDs or SIDs, as they're sometimes called, nationally in Boscombe to try and help traffic flow?
Yes, sorry, what they call again?
SPIDs or SIDs, you know, they smiley face to indicate if traffic's going too fast.
Oh, right, no, sorry, I'm not aware of that.
No. Okay, just maybe we can put some posters up on the TARDIS when it would be allowed to, would we, for the forum? It's a nice central location.
What we are in the process of doing is, obviously, I know the TARDIS has got a visual display on it. We're looking at upgrading that to show sort of helpful tips. To members of the public around crime prevention. One of our biggest things at the moment, it was a media campaign that came out last week around theft from a motor vehicle, around leaflets, okay? So that big media's come out about warning members of the public about what to do when you lock your car, what to take with you, why you take all your belongings with you, and make sure it's locked.
Yeah, I have two questions. The first is there any chance that police could put up more CCTV in the hotspot areas of Boston, which would help them if they haven't got the manpower to patrol the streets, and it would make us feel a bit safer maybe?
Yeah, we've identified where the hotspots are, and there is CCTV in that area.
Trouble is, it doesn't seem to be used a lot. I mean, I had my wallet stolen, and when the police finally came to me, they said the CCTV wasn't defined enough to see the face of the person who'd actually only just been released from prison that morning because he had a plastic bag with his stuff. So it almost like I couldn't see the point of, and that was in the precinct.
Yeah, I can only apologise, you know, that's happened. But obviously, if the CCTV image isn't good enough, and sadly, we can't, you know, proceed with it.
I've seen it more in places like Romania Lane, Walpole,
I know it costs money, and I know it.
It does. It's not necessarily one for the police to actually discuss, because obviously it won't come out of our budget. It's more one for the council really as well, in partnership with us, because obviously they.
Is it then we should speak to them?
Yes, yeah, obviously in conjunction with the police.
Okay.
Because obviously we're the ones that get, you know, a lot of the data. Obviously when it comes online, we'll get the data, and obviously we can support that application if it goes through.
One last question. Have you any idea when the Boston Community Police Station at the Crescent is supposed to be up and running?
No, at the moment, no. I've heard it was going to be August. Hopefully the PCC will be able to talk about that, but I have organised a meeting for the supervisors to go and have a look at our building, and then we should be able to get an update on that. But the PCC is nodding at me, so he probably will know better than me.
Do you know if there's going to be a presence in the evening in that? Do you know?
No, I've got comments on
that. Well, when we get that open, we'll get them in to update us on that. I'll take questions at the back.
I understand that the 101 has nothing to do with you, so who is it to do with? Who pays for it?
Mr. Underhill, who's the Police Crime Commissioner, will answer any of those questions about 101.
Okay.
Okay. I deal with the tactical and neighbourhood deployment in Boscombe, so
okay,
he'll be able to talk to you about that.
Do we have any other questions?
you at the door earlier, I keep confusing dispersal orders, and you mentioned the other power that's coming into force, where officers can kind of exclude people from certain areas for certain periods of time.
Yeah,
what was that called again, sorry?
Yeah, it's called Section 35.
Section 35.
Yeah, it's a dispersal power. If you suspect, for example, there are people causing antisocial behaviour, likely to cause crime, then actually the police are empowered, in conjunction with the council, to actually issue something called a Section 35 dispersal notice. That enables the inspector to sign a dispersal power for up to 48 hours, and if those persons then are required to leave that area for a period of time.
My point for asking, behind asking the question, is that a lot of people that are subject to this order are homeless. They've got nowhere to disperse to. So we're ending up with this balloon effect. You're dispersing people from sort of the economic areas when it's sort of shoplifting and the business rate payers, but then it gets pushed out into the neighbourhood, the community, the people that you know, are phoning 101. And I'm wondering as well, that this authority is being passed down to CPSOs and these new patrol security people we've got. And I know at the Housing Forum we've discussed that this might be against people's human rights, that you can't disperse people just willy-nilly. And to give that authority to some kind of security guard type chap seems a bit irresponsible. Can you tell me how many times you're having to use this dispersal order, Section 135, in Boscombe?
Section 35, yeah, I can't give you the definitive figures on that. I can get them for you for next time, if that's alright, and let you know how many times we've used it.
Can you give an example of why
it was used? I mean, hypothetically, because I can't give you a factual one, but for example, if a person is shouting, swearing, banging on the door, shouting, swearing at a member of public, and they're refusing to go, then that's an ideal situation, and you could actually get someone to disperse from that area. It's not forever, it can be. The area becomes live for 48 hours, and that means you can actually disperse someone for up to 24 hours if you wish.
Am I all right? This Section 35 is currently not being used because there's some sort of problem with the business forum was mentioned, and they weren't using anymore. Whilst there was something to do with human rights, people need to access doctors, surgeries, facilities, things like that, and so the police have stopped using it?
It's still in play. We can still use it. It's a piece of legislation that was handed down. We can still use that. But obviously, we need to take into account people who live in that area. It's very much like there was an old piece of legislation called Section 27. If you lived in that area, obviously, it's difficult to get dispersed from that area because you need to come out and go to the doctors, go to the shops. So obviously, that needs to be taken into consideration. Section 35 is no different.
I sort of ended my own question, really, but is there any truth in this rumour that those powers are being delegated down? Or is that something is it getting delegated down to people who aren't sort of verified police?
I think the question is being asked because actually nationally, PCSOs can use it. I think in Dorset we've decided not to at the moment. Yeah. I think it's at the discretion of Chief Council.
Hello, I witnessed something today where a community enforcement officer today probably using that, chewing someone on from McDonald's, and in turn ended up an assault on this man by 7 police officers today, just trying to get him to move on. And how they acted today was disgraceful. And I got in their way and they threatened to arrest me as well. So I think handing down powers to community enforcement officers, but in turn, I don't think that's right. You know, it should be dealt with properly, you know, by a police officer, not by someone who's not properly trained. I don't believe they're trained. You know, they assaulted this man today and there'll be a complaint later, but I'll take that with someone else. But, you know, but I don't believe that sort of thing should be handed down.
Yeah. Okay, so it's duly noted. The police do have a complaints procedure, so I don't really want to talk in relation to that, but obviously you've got your rights, so, yeah.
Okay, have we got any other questions regarding, here we go. I think so, but some of the feedback we get, particularly about police always come to the forum, is that we just get told statistics, so specifically what's gone up, we found out about that. The statistics themselves are kind of a nebulous thing. I mean, for example, how many neighbourhood watch schemes do we have in Boscombe? I mean, do you actively go out and consult the community about setting up neighbourhood watch schemes? Because they can be very effective in areas when people are looking out the window, phoning things through, keeping logs. Are there a lot of them, or are there hardly any? Do you actively go out?
I can't answer that question, but I do know there are some, and I am going to a forum around neighbourhood watch in Blandford in the next month with a view to becoming a favourite neighbourhood watch and looking to improve our links with neighbourhood watch and actually hopefully set up some more, because I know there are some areas within Bournemouth East as a whole where there are no neighbourhood watches.
I mean, as we're trying to build up a community here, you know, I think maybe that's something you could put some time and effort in, which might see real, you know, difference to people, with not only are they talking to each other, but they're working together to clean up an area, you know, so...
No, I fully agree.
And I think it's probably easier for them, rather than every single person sort of sitting for 20 minutes on one-on-one, you know, and then just kind of won't bother with that anymore, because it just takes, you know, they never answer, blah, blah, blah. You know, that maybe, you know, they could have someone's number, they can bring things straight through, they'd be getting someone to come visit, look at their logbooks and things like that. I think it would be very useful in the area for people. I think I only know one neighbourhood watch in Boscombe.
Right, yo, my question. I run around this area quite regularly because the kids go to school here. I regularly see various degrees of fouling in the area, and I'm wondering how the police are dealing with that.
Is that dog fouling?
No, human fouling too.
Oh.
I live in Havelock Place, and the area behind there is commonly used as a toilet. And I'm wondering what can be done in the local area to tidy that up. I regularly find the bins have either had piles of feces or piss in it. And it's quite disgusting when I have a 2-year-old.
No, I totally agree with you. Right. Obviously, multi-agency approach is the best way to deal with those. Obviously, I know the council will have a responsibility to, you know, clear that area up. But obviously, have you made anyone aware of it? I think it's the biggest thing. Have you rung anyone about it? I don't want to put you on the spot, but I think that's the way. If you tell someone, we can deal with it.
I am aware that people in the Havelland Place block have alerted the police themselves, because I have kind of relatives in the block. Personally, I haven't, but I mean to, and this is kind of my opportunity to move forward, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, absolutely. If I need more details after I've sat down, and then we'll come up with a multi-agency approach for you, because you can't live like that. All right. But also, I've got to bear in mind, it's not necessarily a primarily police issue. That's more of a...
I mean, how would local residents with a similar problem, where would they go? Would that be normally the council?
Or if they know the landlord slash landlady or multi-occupant,
there are a few areas where obviously they do get problems, but probably the council, in the council.
Council, or if you know who the social landlord is for that area, they've got a responsibility.
They've got a responsibility to serve the landlord, so that's quite interesting. Okay.
So I've noticed on the bridge there's some graffiti that's, I guess, inciting racial hatred. And I was wondering who we speak to about that, or if you've noticed anything in the Boscombe area that's anything else like that.
No, whereabouts is that? Which bridge?
It's on the bridge just on this road on Ashley Road.
Which is out there, yeah. The road bridge.
Yeah.
I haven't noticed that.
Yeah, there's a few on the inside of the bridge. So when you're walking through, there's a few things written there that's obviously...
People write it in a certain way. We could do some research around, you know, we can tag using spray cans. That can be researched because certain people use identifiable tags. But obviously, if it's incited racial hatred or anything of that nature, take it very, very seriously. It is a, what we call a hate crime, and that needs to be followed up. Okay, so we will deal with that robustly, but obviously, if we don't know about it, can't really deal with it, sadly. But obviously, if we do subsequently find out about it, we will deal with it. Actually, initially, probably because it is a crime of criminal damage, then you can ring 101 and report it that way. Okay? And then we will investigate it. And then we've got certain things we can do to try and investigate it. Right? Obviously, sometimes it's a little bit difficult, but nonetheless, we will do our best to investigate. Okay?
And I think part of the problem is people don't really know who to report things to. So you try and report something to the police, they say, oh, that's the council. You try and report things to the council, they say, oh, that's the police. And people are just running backwards and forwards everywhere, really, over things. And it would be really good to just have a simple guide with emails and things as to what comes under who, really. Because we keep hearing it's multi-agency, so okay, it's multi-agency. Who did you talk to then?
Yeah, no, I know what you're saying. I think traditionally, the majority of people would know who to go to. Obviously, sometimes I know the lines are blurred about who's got responsibility.
Yeah, parking on pavement. Parking orders?
Yeah.
Police?
It is. Yeah, parking is decriminalised quite a while ago, so we don't actually deal with that.
You can park anywhere.
No, you can't park anywhere. But obviously there's another agency that deals with that now, and actually I think we have to deal with crime as opposed to parking. You know, serious stuff. But obviously there is another agency that will deal with that. But I get what you're saying. You need to be signposted to it, don't you? There is some work going on in North Bournemouth at the moment. The S&T sergeant there is actually looking at a portal that will signpost people if they've got certain issues they want to report. It'll sort of like a portal you go to if you've got internet access, that is, which isn't everyone, and you can, it tells you what to do, who to report to. But obviously that's in the trial stage at the moment.
I think it was in the newspaper the other day with lots of people ringing 101 with things that like people do with 999. But maybe that's something that can be tackled. But how people do report stuff, I know there's an app for Boscombe where you can take photos on your mobile phone and send them off. But it's very difficult to find out what they're called, how they work, who you ring. So maybe some work, multi-agency work, could be done making that a bit clearer. Question right back here.
This is a question that I've been asked to actually ask you. Do you have recent stats for Stop and Search and Red to Black Men in Dorset, and have these figures increased or decreased?
Yeah, I can answer that. I don't know. I don't know at the moment. I'm sure those figures are actually kept around Stop and Search. We do have Stop and Search champions within Dorset Police to make sure there's the majority of people aren't stop search for the wrong reason, just based on their ethnicity. But the answer is I don't know. I'll check, and I don't see why not.
Well, maybe that's an action point.
Because actually, you could ask for a freedom of information request from Dorset Police, and you may reveal those too. But actually, if it appears to be pertinent, then yeah, absolutely.
We'll make that an action point and we'll follow up on that. Got a question on the back here.
Recently on TV they were talking about a texting service for Hampshire Police. It's already operated by the British Transport Police. Our Dorset can do that. It's a way of reporting a crime without having been seen using your mobile in case anybody's watching you.
It's not what I can answer at the moment. I don't know. Do you know who's sitting around that?
We are planning to.
Yeah, we are planning to. So I think it'd be better if you can redirect that to the BCC, maybe it'll answer that, because I don't know. I know we've got various other initiatives in place to sort of streamline our processes, so we can free up the officer's time a bit more.
And just one other thing. You say that some people aren't quite sure who to report crime to or shouldn't to. Recently, one of the gentlemen owning a business opposite the Crescent reported to the police he had criminal damage to his property and to his car. He told Bob Higgins, the operator, that it was on private land and therefore it could not be dealt with by the police. Now, I had an incident like that back in 1985, and that seems to be the same attitude. That would mean you wouldn't be able to deal with rape, burglary, domestic violence or anything, because everybody's property is private land. And maybe it's your operators and your CAD office or CAD department that is not giving the right information to the caller. And that's what frustrates some people. I know that gentleman has reported to the police that there is drug dealing going on from the premises above, about 20 or 30 visits a day. And because he reported it, he had his property damaged. He said the police told him they couldn't deal with it because it was private land.
Obviously, I don't know the circumstances of that, but obviously, is he a friend of yours?
No.
No? But do you have contact with him?
No.
No. What I'm trying to get at is if he's got an issue that he's discussing, he can come to me and we can discuss it and see whether we've taken the appropriate action. Because if we haven't, then we can try and put it right.
Well, he said he's been to the police 4 or 5 times because he has a convenience store there. He's often got shoplifting and things like that. And basically, he says he gives up.
It's a difficult one for me to answer without actually speaking to the gentleman himself. It's just hearsay at the moment. So if you want me to put him in touch with me, then we can discuss it and hopefully move forward on it.
Okay, I think we're getting near the end of the time. And okay, is there any last question before we move on? I'll take one last question from Celia and then we'll go on to the Crime Commissioner.
Just general safety, cars going down the wrong one way, Wolverton Road, every day I see cars going the wrong way, there's going to be some nasty smashes. Cyclists on pavements, these are all things that can be stopped. Nobody's stopping it though.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing is, do we know about it?
Why don't you know about it?
I don't know, because people have got to tell us. Do they? Yeah, can I just ask you who it's been reported to, and then I can sort of check out.
There'll be a head-on between a police car and a car going the wrong way. When you come down on Roots and Roads, which I see out my front window, I'm surprised that it happened.
Okay. So this is, I'll deal with it now. Is it a daily occurrence?
Yes. Yeah.
All right.
And certainly cycling all the way, all the time, yes. And cars, and we're going to fill them up.
I mean, it helped a little bit. They did remark the white lines and no entry, but it didn't last. I think that the next day someone's going to say,
Absolutely. Okay, I'll take that one on board, and we'll do some enforcement work around Walton Road about the road itself.
Saying
it must be
valid. Okay. I think maybe, as we go forward with the neighbourhood plan, maybe, we can pick up a piece of bookings and put your neighbourhood watch things where you get better feedback, because people come in with lots of issues. Sometimes people feel they're not getting listened to. I know they're not talking to businesses, they sort of give up calling things in. So maybe that's something we can work as a forum to getting a better communication stream going. Okay, thank you very much, Matt.
Okay. Thank you very much for your time. And I know it sounds poorly, but we are committed to keeping you safe. If you've got any problems, come to us, please. We're there for you.
Deputy Inspector. May I like to, I'm very pleased to welcome Martin Undo. I've been trying to get him for a little while. We've had a few issues over the last year raised, and I've asked them just to do a brief presentation about those specific things. Obviously 101 comes up every single time, but also it's been raised about unrecorded crime, which is when a crime is reported but it's not been recorded properly. And also things that unreported crime where people maybe are getting fed up, constantly ringing up about drug dealers or ringing up about this, waiting on the phone, and how much crime that actually goes unreported, which isn't shown in the statistics. So Martin's going to give us a 10-minute thing, and then he's going to be able to take about half an hour of questions and answers, but you can ask him anything. Thank you.
Thanks, very good evening, everybody. Before I talk about what I was asked to talk about, which is Matt, I'll try and answer some of the questions that came up to Matt. Where's Matt? To be fair, we've got three councillors here. We've got a very light effect, because one of the questions that were asked are councillor issues. The survey someone asked about is a council survey, and Sue is sitting in the audience. Sue arranged that survey, so I'm going to ask Sue to talk about that at the end. The statistics, two or three of you were asked about statistics, knife crime, murders. All I'd ask is a plea, really. You know, we have swamper statistics. Please tell us in advance and we'll turn up and tell you. I haven't got, I've got loads of statistics and I haven't got knife crime because nobody asked me. So, you know, please, the police come to every forum. I won't tell them to come to most of them. Just send an email to Harry a week before or a week and day before saying, can you please tell us about so-and-so? We will tell you. I didn't know that question was coming. The niche thing is really interesting. I don't want you to get concerned by niche. This is the biggest change in computing in Dorset Police's history. We have moved about 32 systems into one system. And it's a system that over half the police force in this country use, and it is causing us problems. And here we are 7 weeks later, we're still struggling with our data. It won't go on forever, about another 2 weeks and we'll be able to get our data back. But it's a massive change. And the reason we've done it, which is what Matt touched on, is because as we lose more and more police officers, and we are going to lose more, trust me, we have to have officers doing things smarter and quicker. And that we want them all to have these laptops so they don't have to go back to the station. And to enable that, we have to change to niche. CCTV is a council issue. It's owned and run by the council. It's in the police station. But the cost of that CCTV, £750,000 a year, is run by one of the councils. So again, I'd invite the councils to talk about that. Argus, we've had a problem with asbestos. It's owned by the council. The police are leasing it with the council. We're having a multi-agency hub. But just as we were hoping to launch, some more asbestos was found. So that's why we haven't opened. It was due, as someone said earlier, to open in August. I think it's now going to be September, possibly October. As some of you will know, when you find asbestos, it's an absolute nightmare to get rid of it in a safe way. And it costs a lot of money and it's very difficult to get people wet masks and everything to remove it. So that's why Argus is running late. Neighbourhood Watch was mentioned twice. I'll mention two things. As Police Crime Commissioner, I employ two people who do nothing but launch Neighbourhood Watch schemes. Helen Britton and Elaine Wright. So that's their job. So again, we didn't know we were going to be asked that question. I can't tell you how many Neighbourhood Watches are in Boston, but I can get that figure very quickly and I will get it back to Harry. But the point is we have staff employed to help you launch Neighbourhood Watches. So it is a priority for me, it's a priority for the force, and we will do it if you're interested in one. But you can't force a community to have Neighbourhood Watch. It has to come from the bottom up. The neighbourhood has to ask, then we'll help them. And I have staff who will help you, and they're paid to do that. And also, Matt touched on a virtual neighbourhood watch. This is being piloted in West Ham and Kingston. There's a sergeant up there who's running it for us. And the idea is recognising that people, the younger generation, they want social media, they want electronic, they don't want to turn up at a neighbourhood watch meeting. They want to join an online neighbourhood. And we are moving that way as Dorset Police. So we'll have both, we'll have a virtual neighbourhood watch and we'll have a real neighbourhood watch where we can sit like here and talk as residents. But you have to acknowledge the younger generation wants a different approach. And that's what we're trying in North Bournemouth. And if it works, we'll bring it in across the whole of Dorset. What I want to talk about in a moment, stop and search. The lady asked about stop and search. I can tell you this, that two issues. One, we have a high proportion of black men being stopped in Boston. The reason for that is drugs, and that's been recognised nationally. I have examined stop search in Boston many, many times, so have HMIC, the Manchester Inspectorate of Discovery, so have the London Police, who brought them in to look at it, because we have a lot of black drug dealers coming down from London in Boston. That's what happens. In relation to the specific question you asked, the numbers have gone down. They've gone down across the whole of Dorset, and that's because now the Secretary, quite rightly, has put his screws on the police, excuse the pun, and said, you know, I want to see justifications for when you do stop search. And so nationally, and in Dorset, and in Boston, stop searches have gone down. And that's a good thing, actually, because the ratio of arrests from stop search is not good enough. and the Home Secretary is determined to change that, and I support it. If you're stopped searching by the police, there should be a good reason, and you would expect a high proportion of those people to be arrested, because you would have to have suspicion before you stop someone. So I get that question, and I'm happy to provide those stats to you. I'll do it through Harry afterwards. Okay, so I've got about 5 minutes, because Matt was talking out, which is good, but I'm going to rush through this. I was asked by Harry, how do we know you're recording crime, and how can we trust it? So that's what I'm here to do. And these are the areas I'm going to cover: crime recording, crime statistics, then specifically 101, and then we're going to tell you about what we do in Boston. So, crime recording, some of you will know that the gold standard for police recording was removed last year. And that was because the body that awards the gold standard said we can't trust police nationally to record crime. And I think they were right. The standards, it was postcode lottery as to how crime was recorded, and I think it was quite a good thing they did it, because it made the police and police departments wake up, frankly. And so we have done an awful lot of work in Dorset in the last year to make sure that we are recording things properly and that you can trust those statistics. And the leash system that Matt touched on is one of those reasons. That was commissioned by me. I bought the leash system, it cost an awful lot of money, and I did that when I became police crime commissioner, so I could trust the statistics. And now we have an issue for 7 weeks in, you will find the statistics are far more trustworthy. And the problem is, which is a nightmare for me as a police crime commissioner, is now that we're recording everything properly, crime will rise, and it will rise dramatically. So I can tell you now that crime in Dorset will rise this year. It'll be the first time in 18 years, but we will go through the ceiling because we're doing it properly. So and I've been making that quite publicly known now for about a month. So we've had an 18-year drop in crime. Crime will go up this year in Dorset, and in fact has gone up in most police forces nationally. At the end of April, which is when the police stopped their figures per year, there were only 15 police forces in the country who were still showing reduction in crime. Dorset was one of them, but the other 26 all had an increase, and we will have an increase this year. So, to show you how we're doing and what we do, this is the HMIC is the Her Majesty Inspector of the Stag Group. They inspect the police. They are the checkers checking the checkers. And I just wanted you to look at those two quotes. This is November last year, and they are quite happy that the senior officers and staff demonstrate a high level of understanding of the rules and a genuine commitment to raising standards. And I think that some of that is me, I think some of that is the Chief Constable, and some of that is the fact we've now got Nish coming in. Deputy Chief Constable and I are in charge of making sure we record crime properly. And in fact, the next slide tells you about that. I chair a meeting once a month with the Deputy Chief Constable where we look at how crime is recorded. And what I always do, we call it a dip check. On the day of the meeting, I give the police 6 crimes. And I say, I want to know about the last burglary that happened in Sherborne. I want to know about the last theft of a wallet in Boscombe. They're completely random. They're given to the police on the day, and then I actually go into the system and check them. If they're good, I like the officer to say, well done. And if they're bad, they get a letter from the Deputy Chief Constable asking them on. So we also have Operation Advance. You may have heard about this. Chris Weeks talked about it. This is a different approach to investigating crime and making sure that we actually don't screen all crime out, but actually try and solve it. Operation Advance has been running for about 18 months now, which is why when I got elected as Police Crime Commissioner, we've had positive outcomes for 1 in 5 crimes. And as Matt said, we're now up to 1 in 3. Just under 1 in 3, and that's because of Operation Advance. So, do we record crime properly? I think now I can say yes. I could have said that 6 months ago because of Niche. So let's look at the statistics. Recorded crime for last year, going to the end of April, down by 3%, and as most of you know, it's gone down for 18 years, and I've always said to the Crime Commissioner, you can't keep going down, it's got to level out at some stage, and 26 of the police forces had the level out last year, and for the first time in over a decade, crime rose in this country in those 26 forces. It will rise in Dorset this year. And you can see the bottom outcome right there. Antisocial behaviour incidents are down massively, 12.3%. Now this is for the whole of Dorset, not just Boscombe. Obviously Matt was here to talk to you about your local area, I'm talking about Dorset. Violent crime up nationally, this is the one that Harry and the boss at Forum were really worried about that, so let's talk about that. Violent crime nationally has gone up by 21% and in Dorset by 15%, which is a massive rise, but there are various reasons behind that. One of which Matt's touched on, which is we are getting more and more reports of harassment through Facebook or through Twitter, and that's an electronic cataract harassment that is recorded as a violent crime. The other reason, which is a good thing, is that the police are now recording violent crime better. This was the one that caused the big row last year, where the Home Affairs Select Committee, the Public Affairs Committee, MPs, the Manchester Inspectorate of Constabulary, police crime commissioners, everybody was saying to the police, you're not recording violent crime properly. And this time last year, the police were made to change the way they did it. And that means, of course, the whole country has gone up. So some of it is a recording issue. The other reason is what we call the saddle effect. Violent crime includes sexual assault. And we have seen a massive increase, of course, of historical sexual assaults being reported, nearly a 30% increase in a year. And that's because people are being brave enough to come forward now because of saddle and say, actually, I was abused as a child, my teacher abused me, my dad abused me, or whatever. And some of these offences are 30 or 40 years ago. Now, again, it's a national trend, it's not just in Dorset, but that's a massive reason behind why violent crime has gone up. We've also seen, and this is a good thing, domestic abuse and sexual offences reports going up, which we want people to tell us about the trauma they're going through and the fact they're surviving something that's horrible. So that's some of the reasons why violent crime has gone up and why you were so concerned with your last forum. And we have had an increase in hate crime incidents. I was worried about with what's going on in the Middle East. I was a bit worried about what was happening in the Jewish community, but actually that hasn't gone up too much. We've had seven anti-Jewish incidents in Dorset in the last year. So it happens, and most of those were Bournemouth, obviously, because we have a Jewish community in Bournemouth. But it isn't as bad as I thought it would be. But the other hate crime angles, including homophobic crimes, have gone up, which is good. As BCC, I've employed someone to be an average worker for homophobic crime, and that person is dealing with 22 cases at the moment, some of them in Bournemouth, some of them in Cork, some of them in rural Dorset. So we know homophobic crime is being increased, and we have an average worker to deal with it. Now, I've already going to the bottom of the slide, 2015-16 early indications. Recording crime is increasing. I've given you some of the reasons for that. One of them is improved recording, and I'm happy with that. Two, and I'll put a question mark because let's talk about it, is it austerity? You know, I've been standing in front of your forum. I've come to many, many forums in 3 years, and we've lost 20% of the police force since I've been standing here. So the question you have to ask is it austerity? We don't know. Well, I do know there was a discussion earlier about whether a police officer on the street stops crime. Well, there has been some academic work done in Birmingham this year, which I think the first time it's ever been done, where a professor whose name escapes me, he looked at whether officers in hotspots prevented crime. And he's proved that they do. But only in that hotspot. What he's also proved is if you have an officer walking on the road with nothing to do, basically, which is what Matt talked about, you know, the Dixon and Doc Green approach, he proved that didn't work. But what he did prove was if you have hotspots, i.e. the precinct in Boston, you know, I don't need to tell you Boston is the busiest area in Dorset. This is the most busy area for policing in Dorset. If you have an officer in a hotspot, you will prevent the crime. And that's been proved academically. And that's why Dorset Police is demand-led, and that's why we are now doing threat, risk and harm, looking at where the demand and hotspots are and putting the officers there. Now, the downside of that is that if you're not in a hotspot, you're not going to see an officer. You can't have it both ways, particularly when you lose a fifth of your workforce. And the last one is improved confidence in reporting. I've just talked about that, and it quotes the saddle effect. Okay, so just to reassure you, because I really get the feeling in this forum that people don't trust the police stats. So the police are one of the most scrutinised bodies in this country. And I'm just giving you some examples. So the Office of National Statistics, they check the police against 8 different areas. The Home Office, the Home Secretary, hold me to account for 8 different areas, including use of terrorism, stop and search, we've already talked about. I see someone writing something down. I'm happy to pass this presentation on. Harry, can you put this on the website? Crime statistics, the Independent Police Complaints Commission. Six different areas of policing are examined by them, and I'm held to account. Police UK, which any of you can go to, put your postcode in and tell you what's happened. That looks at six different areas, including 101. And then, obviously, I'm held to account by the Talks of Police and Crime Panel. So there is an awful lot of scrutiny going on. But I do take the point that you can only scrutinise something if the figures are right. But I am more and more confident in my three-year journey as a Police Crime Commission that the figures in Dorset are getting better. So, 101. This dominates my life. But I am going to start off with a really simple statement. It's a non-emergency phone number. And what I find all the time, and it's interesting, there's three councillors in the audience, I get loads of councillors coming to me with complaints. And before they've even got halfway through, I've stopped them and said, that's a 999 call. Why did you dial 101? Or why did the constituent dial 101? People are using 101 for the wrong reasons. We'll talk about that in a moment. But also, it is a non-emergency service. And if you have drug, for example, one that keeps coming up in Boston, is a drug deal going down. That's a crime in action. That's a 999 call. That is not a 101. If you see someone dealing in drugs, you dial 999. I can't put any complaint on that. It's a non-emergency number. Please do not dial 101 to tell us about a drug deal. That is a crime in progress. We have 1,300 calls a day. That's 32,000 calls a month. Now, I'm just going to give you some statistics before I turn my page, because we need to keep this in perspective. If you have 32,000 calls, I'll get that. Let's put it in perspective with how many complaints we get. And most of the complaints, 85% of the complaints, come through my office. And most of the complaints come from the public straight to me. So in May of 2014, we had 10 complaints, and in that month we had 32,000 calls. In May 15, which was 8 weeks ago, we had 80 complaints. Last year, June 14, we had 32 complaints and 32,000 calls. And this June, we had 10. And in July 14, which was when we had a huge blip, because we merged two control rooms into one, we had 49 complaints. That's the busiest month of complaints since I've been Police Crime Commissioner. And we had 32,000 calls. And this month, standing here now, in this whole county, we've had 6 complaints. So I've got to put it in perspective, because people keep going on about 101. I don't get told about it, and neither do the police. And my plea to you, I'm not saying there isn't a problem, what I'm saying is, I need to know about the problem. So these complaints do not reflect what I get told on every street corner in Dorset. I go all over Dorset. And everywhere I go, people complain about 101. And my first question to all of them is, have you complained about it? Have you told me about it? Have you told the police about it? Have you phoned in to complain? And nobody does. And my plea to you, and these councillors here know this, because I challenged former councillors the other day and said, tell me what's going on there. And suddenly overnight, I had 12 complaints coming. Or 12 emails on 101. Actually, three of them were praising 101, and 9 of them were complaints. And when I gave you those stats for June, 10 complaints, 9 of them came from former councillors, because I asked them to tell me. So I'm pleading with you, if you have a problem with 101, please tell me, because I can't challenge the police unless you let me know. 90% of calls are answered within 30 seconds. And we then grade and prioritise them. And we do have available other alternatives. We have a callback service, that's new. We have an email facility, that's new. We have calling during off-peak times requesting. For me, that isn't new. What I'm saying there is, if you phone on a Monday morning at 9 o'clock, just when all the businesses are open, and some of them have had their premises broken into, and schools are reopening after a weekend, and some of them have been broken into, I can guarantee you, if you dial 101, 9 a.m. Bear in mind, it's a non-emergency service, so you don't need to tell us straight away, because if you do need to tell us straight away, you're dialing 999. Do not phone 101 at 9 o'clock on a Monday morning, because you will wait 32 minutes to get answered, because that is our busiest time of the week, because every business, every school, and every member of the public is phoning us because they've just gone back to work. So, common sense has to apply. If you phone us in the evening, you've got more chance to get answered. If you phone us any time Monday morning at 9 o'clock, you've got more chance of being answered. And the callback system works. We've also introduced a system where you can now leave a number on a collar. So, Matt, what's your collar?
581.
So, Matt is 581. You can actually remotely punch in 581 and a message goes to Matt without speaking to somebody. So I am trying, as Bruce Fire Commissioner, to make this work. I would make two points that I made to councillors the other day when I spoke to them about 101. This is a national service. The government brought it in. This isn't a Dorset 101, it's a national service. 111 is the National Health Service. 101 is the National Police Service. The money that you're charged, which always gets raised in public meetings, isn't mine. You're charged 12p and it goes to the government. And they get £137 million because people dial 101 and 111. And we don't see any of it. So that is just two issues that I would point out. We have to have 101. And we have to get the money to the government. So I'll take questions on 101 at the moment. I'm now going to give you some examples of calls we've received. Harry quoted this just now. I'll tell you about a couple of others as well. So these are the sort of calls we get. And because of the complaints from councillors and the public about 101, the Chief Constable and I are taking quite an unusual step. We are now going to write to people who've dialed us inappropriately. And write to them and tell them how much that's cost the taxpayer. And tell them the people waiting in the queue while you told us about, can we have a taxi number? What time is the bank open? How do I deal with a jellyfish thing? Please, can you pick up my drunken son? I can give you others. I listened to these the other day. I've got a squirrel in my chimney. What do I do? And another one, pokes down, there's a deer in my garden. Really? And that's why you're queuing to get your 101 call through. So we're now going to write to these people and tell them how much it costs the taxpayers. Tell us that they've got a screw in their chimney.
How much
would
that cost the taxpayer
for
the
electricity?
Sorry? How much is that going to cost the taxpayer for the
electricity? A lot less than it takes to answer that call. And actually, we've got to try and reduce this demand because we something like 30% of our calls are not appropriate. They're either going to the wrong agency, and this has been talked about earlier. I'm going to do questions again, that's right. It's all being raised here that what we go to the council and they say go to the police, you go to the police and say go to the council. What I would love to achieve, which is a dream, is a 101 service that is every agency. And that's not that far away, I don't think. In 5 years, why wouldn't we do that? So you dial 101 to speak to the council, to speak to the education service, to speak to the police, or speak to the fire brigade about a non-emergency incident. So that would make total sense to have a public services number, but of course it needs government intervention, not from me. But we've got to stop this demand because we have 1 in 3 calls is not an appropriate call to the police and non-emergency number, which means other people who have got an appropriate call are kept waiting. So what have we done in the last year because of the complaints about 101? Well, we've recruited and trained more staff. We have 151 people now answering the phone. When you think the organisation has shrunk by 20% and we only have 1,200 police officers, we have 151 people now answering the phone. We have now introduced report by loss because something like 7 or 8% of calls were people talking about lost property. So we have introduced a system where you can do that online. The voice activated switchboard, I've already mentioned, which means you can now pump in an officer's number and leave a message for that officer. And we've changed, we do have a triage system now, so that when you're answered, you're asked what your issue is, and we triage it. And actually, if you're kept waiting for a long time, normally that means you're finding out something that either is not appropriate, or there's lots of other people with more important issues in front of you. And we have detective sergeants, there's 6 detective sergeants now, who do nothing but screen the calls coming in to prioritise them for the police and to make sure they're dealt with quickly. And we have a mental health street triage, you will know about because I've spoken about it here. And that's about to go to a 999 street triage. We will be the first place in the country to have a street triage system for not just police, but fire and ambulance. Because the fire and ambulance people are dealing with as many people with mental health issues as the police, and fire and ambulance have just agreed to join us. So we can have a street triage system, mental health advice, access to care plans, anybody who contacts the 999 system. So, to finish with, because obviously I know you've got some questions, this is what we're doing in Boscombe. Every time I come to this sort of meeting, people say, well, what are you doing? So this is what we do. The Boscombe Regeneration Partnership is a multi-agency approach. I sit on there as a voting member. So do the councillors sitting in front of you. We work with the chief executive of the council, Boscombe. We have businesses from Boscombe. We have councillors from Boscombe. We have various people from the council who look at strategic issues, trying to make Boscombe better. We have community safety patrol officers, CSPOs. They've been mentioned a lot tonight. They're part of the CSAS scheme, Community Safety Accreditation Service. Now they have to be authorised and licensed by the chief constable, but they're funded by the council. Now actually in Boscombe they're part funded by me as well. This is a new initiative that was brought in last year. It's had a tremendous effect because when they started, they were doing 300 incidents a week in the Sovereign Centre area. That's a huge amount of demand taken away from the police, low-level stuff that they can deal with. I have taken away today, and I take away as an action from you, this Section 35 dispersal order. PCSOs don't use that power, I can tell you that now. Matt touched on that. But what I didn't know until tonight was that the CSPOs do, and I will look at that, because obviously the Chief Constable's licensed that, and I wasn't aware they were using the dispersal order, so I'll come back to you on that. Operation Moped is a drug crime initiative. You obviously saw a huge drug initiative about 6 months ago in Boscombe, when about 21 drug dealers were arrested. Operation Galaxy has been going for 2 years, but we've now gone to phase two. Again, it's been a crime commission. I'm helping fund two analysts in that initiative, which is looking at making the HMOs respond better, basically, and look after vulnerable residents. Street sense worker outreach. We have a street sense worker. It's called Operation Planning. Chris Weeks has talked about this before in this setting. And the community hub, obviously, when we dealt with the asbestos issue, and I'm looking at the councils. Can you update me on that? Do you know any more? So,
September is the last
time. Yes, as soon as you said, she's on one phone. There's been hiccups, yeah, it's called asbestos. And we're still on target for September. And then we've got the police box and the TARDIS. Okay, so over questions, I know you all have an eye come here, I'll get some active questions.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you to Martin. I guess that presentation was just that.
I'm going to bring Matt up as well, because if it's an operational question, normally when I do this, it's me and Chris Weeks. And it's easier if Matt's standing than being one of the operational questions, because I know there will be some of the operational. Hi.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask a question about phoning 101. I find it absolutely impossible to phone on my mobile. What I've had to do is to phone the bottom of the Portland police station, 2222, and they then put me onto the Task Force 4 or something.
Why
don't
you get through 101?
I dial 101 on my mobile and it won't connect me.
That's bizarre. But I will.
So I have to phone the Walmart police station.
Okay. Well, there is some good news there, because if you dial 22222, which was the old number, possibly the Walmart police station, and I shouldn't tell you this, but I will, it's still free. I haven't switched it off yet. So all of you, don't dial 101, dial 01202222222, and you get the call free. But they are going to switch it off soon. But at the moment, you're still going to call him through. I don't know why your mobile doesn't reach 101. That's bizarre. I've never been told that before, so I've never heard of that. That's new to me, sorry. But keep doing 22222, because it's free.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, if I have a squirrel and I've got a fire in the chimney, and if I hear a squirrel, what do I do then?
Sorry,
what do I call an
squirrel
emergency?
Squirrel or a fire?
I have a fire in my fireplace, and in the chimney there's a squirrel. What do I do? How do I get the squirrel out? Who do I dial? What number do I dial? Everyone's laughing when they say they dial 999, but who should they? What should they dial?
Okay, if I live very rurally and I do have some squirrels, I would dial my local vet and say, how do I get the squirrel out? And if I do, you look at it. The problem with squirrels is they carry fleas, and we're really careful about it. But I have caught two squirrels in my house. I put them in cage and take them there. But I'm not convinced it's a police issue.
I'm talking about in a chimney. It's going to die. So you don't worry about
killing squirrels. No, I do care about killing squirrels, but is it a police?
I think it's probably the RSPCA.
I think it's the RSPCA.
Or
a vet.
Or your local vet. Can take another question from the floor then.
person is, they don't provide a warning. There was no fire, it was just a squirrel.
Okay, just taking
that was the fire.
Question over here, let me
just move on now. It was just a squirrel stuffing a chimney.
Oh, hi, I just wanted to ask about the 101. I know it's a pain, but I know lots of people have had problems with it. I know lots of people have had problems with it, myself included, where I've been half an hour trying to get through. So, you don't then want to go on and complain. I didn't actually know who to complain to anyway. I know that now, but I think a lot of people didn't know. Now, I asked before, who pays for that? I mean, where is it? Where does the money come from? Is that coming out of your budget, the police budget, or how much control have you got over what happens with 101? Who has got that control over that?
Okay, so the cost of the 101 system, the control room, is my cost. So I'm the police fire commissioner, it's my budget. You pay your precept, the money comes to me, and I pay for the control room. The control room, the 101 system, costs about £300 a year. So it's 3% of the budget. And as I said earlier, we have 151 people there. But the cost of the call, and it should be 2222222, goes to the government, and we don't see it. And that's really frustrating. And I was with the police minister yesterday, my planning, and I actually raised it again with him and said, look, if you arrest someone and they go to prison and the Proceeds of Crime Act kicks in, you give some of that money back to the people of Dorset, which is right, because the criminal made the money from the public. So why is 101 coming back to the people of Dorset? I really have a problem with this. I have a problem that the central government gets all this money because you're dialing your local police force. It's not right.
Well, I think it would be a good idea if the advertisements for 101, so people are clear that they can phone it and what it's for, also have some sort of link that shows who they should complain to about 101 if they're not satisfied. Because I didn't know who to phone or who to get in contact with. And I know so many people have problems. I think why you haven't had complaints because people don't know who to complain to. And it's not about wanting to whinge, it's about trying to get the system more efficient so that, I've seen things that you think, well, that looks like it might be a drug deal going on, but I'm not really sure, or other things. Certainly if it was a drug deal, I know I've got to phone 999, but there's other things that you think, well, this happened, I know that is a 101 call, but, you know, half an hour on the phone, you give up on me and think, oh, I can't be doing this, this is enough, you know.
And I need to know about that half an hour call. So, what we do at the police is that we have a manager of the call control centre, and we have a gold group. My office sits on that gold group, and we go through complaints every month, and we learn from them. And if an officer makes a mistake, or a staff makes a mistake, we apologise. And sometimes the complaints are justified and some aren't. But I need to know about them. I can't set down and clear it now. Please tell me if you have a one-on-one issue. Each email, all I need to know is what time you called and what phone number you called on. Yeah, what was your mobile number, your landline number? And every call is tapped. So, you know, if there's a dispute about who said what or how long you waited, it will be completely and utterly proven because the tape is there. The computer will say how long you waited. The computer will say how long it took to answer a call the first time and how long after triage they came back to you. It's all there. But I do need to have someone come to me and say this went wrong with it. And I hopefully showed you on that slide. All of those things on that slide have happened in the last year because of public feedback about 101. So I am trying, guys. I am.
Okay, thank you. Come to the next question.
It was just regarding the reason, almost for the crime issue at this forum and the stats from the last forum being so surprising. I think we're saying obviously, but it's not as bad as you think, all those things. But I think the relevance of why that was such a shock, and it kind of comes down to the comms framework exception we've put in place, it's about communication. And I think what the surprise there was is we, there's that kind of glossing over something, and it was only a member of the public here digging those facts. So what was being told was everything's getting better, there's a reduction, overall reduction, that's really nice. And it was only members of the audience then that started digging in to say, well, what's gone now? And then obviously the surprise that it's violent crime, those, you know, violence against the person. So I suppose it's just, you know, it's a question as such, or a statement, just, you know, can we work again with this communication framing section? That dialogue is very important, that if the public feels, and I personally feel this, I know people that come forward feel this, that if you're not honest and open with the information you're giving, it then allows for suspicion. And I think you said the stats, you know, they tell a story, but actually what you're doing, you know, now with the new mechanisms in place to make those stats better, well, that's all really good, but those communications get lost when, as I said in the last forum, it's all rosy days when actually you have to dig and find out that it's not. If you presented that for a start, really nice and clear, let's have that open dialogue, open discussion. Again, it comes back to the common framework session. That's what we're trying, to initiate and allow to have better communication.
Okay, so two things. One, most of you now know me, I've been coming here for a while. I don't deal with all rosy at all. I've just sat here and said to you, somebody will get me on electric quality, which is crime's going to go up this year. And I'm telling you now before it happens. It's not going to happen for 9 months. You'll hear this in January next year, and go, oh, no, you said that possible last year. I don't do roads, but I do what happened. I wasn't wanting to go to stats with you, it's the police. I keep saying, if you ask the stats, we'll give it to you. Matt will give it to you. There's nothing to hide, honestly. But, yeah, and I'm not happy to go to you as a forum, but you haven't asked. We've been emailing all week. Cathy's been trying to contact Harry, saying, what's coming up on Thursday? Just tell us what you want, we'll give it to you. You haven't asked.
But in that instance of the last forum, you were presenting facts and you then presented facts in a seemingly, just a little bit, trying to put a spin on it. And it's like, well, actually, if you're coming to present facts, just present them. As you just said, the way that you do, being honest and open, that's really,
I take the feedback. I do think it goes both ways.
I mean,
you've got to ask the facts.
From my
experience, we'll tell you. Or at least.
I mean, from my experience, I mean, I probably hear the statistics maybe 6 or 7 times a month. And for the last year, I've been hearing overall crime is down. Oh, it's a fantastic success. Burglary is down, dwelling things. And even me, I've been aware that there's been a national rise in violent crime. But I've never actually thought to say, well, has violent crime gone up? Impossible. It was just a little lady here who sat there. A whole year. I think it's something, and it was a big shock. It wasn't just to us, it was to everyone in the community. So I think what you're saying is maybe that this actually is an issue in the area, something that people need to be aware of. And how can they move forward like neighbourhood watch schemes? I mean, I'm very interested to get one of your guys along to the next forum to talk a little bit about neighbourhood watch and how to set one up so that we put it out on the internet and people have an idea. Because you say you can't force people to do it. But if they're aware of it, how to do it, and it's quite a straightforward thing, then they might be more likely to. And in Boscombe, it would be a really good place to see some more of those come in. If I chase you up about that, maybe we could arrange one of those two guys to come, possibly, or do an online presentation or video that we could show information.
I'm more than happy to take away an action to get a neighbourhood watch talk to your next forum. I'm trying to stop this conspiracy theory. You know me. And I have been saying across the whole of Dorset for the last year, violent crime's going up. It has been going up for the last year, it's not a surprise. And I've said it in this forum, I've said it about you ago when I spoke last time. So, I think
it's more the policeman who comes in, he has a...
Well, I think Matt got that out of the room and we'll feed that back to Chris Williams. Okay. It's no secret. I've been saying for a long time that the Sandal effect I've been talking about for a year, violent crime is always going to go up, the overall crime in Dorset will go up this year. You heard it here first. I'm not hiding anything.
Move on to the next question.
It's not really a question, it's going back to about asking the police about the stats. I was actually given that question yesterday, so I couldn't ask Harry, and about stop and search. So I did ask him here, and I'm actually surprised that you actually didn't have the stats, but I was asked the question.
It's a good question to ask. I'll get you the stats. I can't produce it overnight. Sorry. There are thousands of stop searches in Dorset every month. I have the answer in my office. I don't have it here in my pocket, frankly. But it's a good question to ask. It's the one area nationally that Dorset is in the spotlight for. We stop and search more people in Boscombe than most places in the country. And I have done a lot of work to examine that. I'm quite happy why. But But it's a good question. I will answer it. I'll answer it tomorrow. I didn't know how to answer that.
We'll follow that one up. Yeah.
The question was from a black person. And we know why you stop and search, and you don't want people in drugs. It's the way it's done. And a few years ago, I worked with Inspector Weeks, what's his name, I can't remember his second name.
Sergeant.
Yeah.
About
stop and search and engaging with black men. Right, so, because it was bad, but I know it's gone down, and this is what I said, it has to have gone down.
It has gone down.
I was actually asked that question, from someone who had been stopped and searched, and they think it's inappropriate, the way they were stopped, so I'm asking that question.
No, sorry, I don't mean to. You start your video on criticising me. I'm not criticising you. I think it's a good question, arguably the best question asked here tonight. It's really important. Stop search is under scrutiny. And what I'm talking about doing with my team is two things. What I'm going to do is what NSN did for National Economic Secretary last year. I'm going to commission a survey of people who are stop searched in Boston to ask them how they felt about it, if you can have your point. And the other one I want to do is taser. I want to actually go and speak to the people who can taser and ask them how they felt about it. So I'm totally on your page. I just haven't got the stats. I'm sorry. I will send it.
Okay, we'll move on to the next question. Keith.
Hi. I'm going to have a bit of change the subject. Excuse me, Mr. Uphill. I don't know who here can answer this, but I'm hoping you all can. Forward planning. There's been a great deal of news and delight from some quarters about Bournemouth Football Club going up in the league, I believe. Okay? Now, as a local resident, we talked before about the traffic situation in one-way streets locally. Can you tell me, is there a multi-agency group addressing what is going to happen to Boscombe? Because we already get gridlocked. We get the residents' parking is completely overrun, the streets are completely gridlocked, and there's been a lot of hype suggesting that the crowds will get busier. So can you tell me, I don't know if the councillors or yourself, is there some sort of group working on this?
So Phil's just going to come and answer that. And because you asked the other question, when Phil stands up, I'm going to ask him to talk about SIDS as well, because SIDS, mapping, speed indication device. They are normally put in by the councils, but councils have road enforcement officers.
So you're not involved in anything to do, any discussion groups with an overview?
Hang on, I'm getting there, sorry. So the SIDS thing, the councils are talking about, because it is a council-driven initiative. And the football, I'll leave councillor Watts to talk about, but from a police perspective, just to reassure you, the public order scenario, people really worry about public order, there's more statistically, again, less statistics, there's more trouble in the Championship than in the Premiership. So when Bournemouth got promoted, actually, the chances are there'll be less public order issues at the football ground. The thing that's concerning everybody, and I'll invite the council to talk about it, is what happens if 6,000 people come down for the weekend? We are the only seaside Premiership club. That's it. We are the only one with seaside. So people are worried, rightly so. Will 6,000 people come down to watch it in the pubs because they're a goon now and they haven't got a ticket, and then rep Bournemouth? I can't answer that. I'll leave the council to answer that. The police tell me they have plan B if that happens. We have a gold group that's looking at the football to answer your question. The police have what we call a gold group. The police form gold groups if there's a problem. So if the badger gold comes to Dorset, we'll form a gold group. If 101's a problem, which it is, we form a gold group. And there is a gold group formed for football. So I do think it's now time to answer. You've got away really lovely tonight, guys. I'm now going to give you over to the councillor.
Thank you very much. The council have a task and finish group looking into the road situation with regard to the football club, because it is a whole new ball game in the Premiership, as most people know. Thank you for that. And I will really ask the police about the situation, about what they're going to do on their behalf, because it's a multi-agency approach at the end of the day. And it's important that we get to grips with the situation. And I'm not on the task of finishing with myself, but I'm obviously the public can come along to these meetings. So we do hope to get to grips with the situation through part of the football club, but it is a whole new ball game in the Premiership, and it's kind of watch this space. I have asked for a seating capacity in the stadium to be increased, which they haven't done, but they have a really number of issues within the football club to expand the situation, to bring up to Premiership standards. That's all I've got to say on the issue.
Thank you. And you'll know that Tobias Elwood, the MP, is campaigning loud here for a better slip road. I get the point about the gridlock. I've got friends who live under the arse of football ground and play hand Saturdays.
Okay, we can move on to the next one. I want to if we can keep questions short and concise, as we're running out of time, and we wanted a bit of a general thing at the end.
Mr. Commissioner, on Monday evening at 7:35, I had to make a 999 call for somebody threatening one of the shopkeepers in the Crescent. He went away to say he's going to get a knife. I made the 999 call. That 999 call lasted 18 minutes. I was asked 11 times for the postcode. I was asked loads of other questions, but no police officer turned up, and I eventually got a crime number texting me the next day. Now, you may not be aware of what's going on, and there might be other people doing things, and you think they're doing something different, but at the last meeting, Inspector Setchell spent 45 minutes with me afterwards, and I was assaulted in the Crescent on the 21st of April this year. I had 11 people come to help me. Two of them had the witnesses' statements taken, the others haven't. He told me by email to my government office, because I too am covered by the Official Secrets Act, and I've been in touch with your police force, and nothing's happened. He was good enough to email me, ask for a meeting with me, which I haven't been able to arrange yet, but he said he had given the incident to a different officer who would contact me. Didn't happen. I'm sorry, despise is a strong word, but I have absolutely no faith in your police force whatsoever. Not you, but you've got police officers that are misbehaving. And in 2010, four police officers were removed from Boscombe Police Station, kept quiet about it, and after a year, all retired. I know what that means, and you know what that means. And I had one of those officers, four recordings of him threatening me, and your professional standards refuted everything about it. And when I contacted the IPCC, I was told by professional standards they would not help me if I went down that road.
Okay, so you've raised three issues there. The first one was 2010, corruption. You haven't asked me about that or told me about that, so I'll ask that.
I did on the 22nd of January, we had a meeting at the end here. You told me your PA was going to contact me. After we contacted your officers three times, all the calls which you can have to your officers in 2013, leaving messages for your PA. Well, I got through on the fourth occasion. She told me you wouldn't be interested. It wasn't an incident or things that you've dealt with. I've since received a letter from a sergeant who's been moved from Boscombe Police Station to Winton, who wrote to me telling me he has told the SDO, station desk officers, not to deal with my incidents.
Okay, I think we're getting a few. It's not my police force, okay? Matt is a police officer. I'm here to scrutinise the police. I certainly do not recall ever hearing from you about these incidents. You raised three incidents. I'm here in hospital tomorrow, actually, running surgeries. I'm happy, but when we finish this tonight, I'm happy to talk to you about it, okay? The 999 call you just quoted is a classic example. It's all talent. And you're saying you're after 11 times for a postcode, but let's find out if that's true, because it is the police need to answer it. So if you hang on till after meeting, I will take the details.
And you're here for surgery tomorrow, did you say?
I'm here tomorrow for surgeries.
Is that no time for surgery, or?
Well, to be fair, it was open. All the slots have gone. It was sort of spinning the echo. I've got six people saying it tomorrow morning, so I'm here from 10 till 1.
Okay, take another question.
Mr. Underhill, of all the elected sort of representatives that we've got, I find you the most trustworthy and the most reliable, and that's what I know you've got a really difficult job. But obviously, in Boscombe, and Boscombe being one of the hot spots, it's good to have a sort of chat to talk to. You touched upon austerity and the way that the crime statistics and to go through the roof. I was at a meeting last night and it's all about looking after children, child sexual exploitation. And the officer there said that since they started diligently looking at the record, sort of statistics have gone up by something like 700%. The children are possibly at risk. So you sort of exposing the truth and what's really going on. Austerity is a political decision, and I want to talk to you about the criminals that are behind that. You know, I'm sure you understand the principles of public office and the sort of the principles that the police operate by, without fear or favour. And I want to ask sort of the question, how likely do you think it would be that if I approached the police and tried to point out evidence of white-collar crime? Back in the old days, you used to be able to trust your local councillors and the people down there at the town hall. They were there to look after people in the borough, but it's not like that anymore. In the last few years, everything's changed dramatically, and these councillors and directors are kind of arms length management groups and trusts, and there's lots of examples of white-collar crime going on. So if I walked into a police station, like you helped me do recently, and we gave the evidence of how a senior ranking council employee was kind of double-bugging the books, how many white-collar criminals are reported to you? How much of this intergovernmental fraud that's going on? Because we're suffering because of white-collar criminals, sir.
Okay, there's two bits there, really. One is white-collar crime, the other is, saying is politicians who are breaking the law. If politicians break the law, you do need to report it. Well, actually, you'd be surprised. I've had several reports come to me, and I forward them to the police, because it's not my job to investigate it. But people tend to come to me to tell me they think somebody is being corrupt. And I have had several. Obviously, I won't talk about that here. So please, if you do think someone is being corrupt, you need to tell me, and I will forward it to the police.
The innocent ones involved, though, there was no further action. We took solid evidence, myself and another respectable member of this forum. We went to the police station, gave our statements, and nothing was done. And there's example after example at the moment where sort of public assets are being palmed off. You know, our BCCA, all sorts of things that we thought we could trust the council with. And we need support, we need protection.
Well, I understand that. What you've got to remember is that some of these allegations against councillors, particularly over planning permission, is really complex. And actually, the ones that have come to me, I always insist they go to the Crown Prosecution Service for an independent view. And the case you're talking about, I believe, went to CTS too. So, you know, the police can't discharge because you think someone's done something wrong. You know that, right? So, if anybody, if a complaint's made against me, you know, the Crown Prosecution Service should consider it. I can break the law too. Every politician is liable to break the law.
Well, can we verify one last time, actually? You know, that Northern Principles, it says in the common law, it is a criminal offence for a councillor to withhold information when requested by a member of the public. There's a massive public health...
Okay, the Nolan Principles are not law. And so for the people who want, the Nolan Principles are seven principles of public life. They're not law. They are guidance issued by a Lord Chancellor. And I signed up to the Nolan Principles when I stood for election. But they are not law. So
the contravirus then, exceeding the authority or not living up to authority. We've got this public health meeting at the town hall on Monday where certain facts are going to be disclosed today and I don't know where it is. And our councillors refuse to give us the information or they negate to mention it.
Well, I do think we should take this outside.
Yeah, we just...
You've got councillors here who can ask this, but...
We're getting near 9 o'clock now. I want someone to take one more question. One thing I wanted to raise with you was raised last time, and there was a gentleman who was the chairman of the business forum, and he was here, and he was talking about a business that rank 999, and there was the fixed penalty notice, but it was a crime in action, and there was on exactly the same day, there was another person who was going to come here, but he hurt his leg, he's not here again tonight. And he's been in this forum many times, and he's always raising issues about 101. And they say, well, it was a crime in action, phone 999, and that particular day, which was 2 months ago now, he said he'd rang 999 for a fight happening, and he too was threatened with a fixed penalty notice. It was quite interesting.
There was a fixed penalty.
Notices for wasting police time.
Okay, so if a police member of staff, one of those 151 people, is saying, if you phone again and waste our time, we give you fixed penalty notices, that's a sackable offence. We don't issue fixed penalty notices for people dialing 911 by mistake. That's just wrong. So I need the details about that, because everything is taped. So that's what I keep saying. You've made a really serious allegation. Whoever makes sure that said that will lose their job.
Well, I'll pursue with both of these.
I need to know now, because there is no way we would issue a fixed penalty notice because someone dialed 911 by mistake. That is just...
Well, it wasn't by mistake, it was for a crime.
No, I'm saying
it was from, you know, on purpose because it was a crime.
There is no way
Well, I'll chase on both of those, because I'm raising it because it was raised here. Okay. I also raised it to two pretty respectable people. And I was told on the same, as it was, wasn't expecting the other one on the forum, so it was two on one day, but I heard the same.
So if you could give me the time or the phone number they used.
Oh, I will chase them both up and then we'll communicate.
It takes a cap for a year. So, yeah. And if we have got, I'm not saying it's not happening, because people do these expectations. If a member of staff in trouble is saying to people, you dial us again and I'll give you the fixed penalty again. Frankly, they need serious disciplinary action. And because it's all taped, it's there as a matter of record.
Well, I'll pursue it to both of them. I know that both of them are. I'll do that to the floor. I'll take one last question from the floor, and we'll, got one other person who wanted to speak before the end.
Operation Galaxy was monitoring about 20 or so problem HMO properties. Is that still ongoing, or have those problems been resolved?
No, it is still ongoing, and in fact, has increased its scrutiny. So we now have analysts. And we now have more proactive work. We actually have people now enforcing Operation Galaxy and we've employed more staff. So Sue, do you want to talk about that quickly?
I wanted to answer the question.
Right, so I'm going to ask Sue to come up to talk about surveys, and I'm going to ask Sue to talk about Operation Galaxy, only because it is a council-led operation that I help fund.
Well, there's not an awful lot more to say about Operation Galaxy other than what Martin said. It's been very successful. Because it's been successful, we wanted to expand it. We've got more offices in there. It'll be dealing with more properties and taking more action. So that is a very good news story. And the Police and Crime Commissioner has contributed funding towards that to make sure that we can be even more effective. But you did invite me earlier. You said I got off lightly. There were a couple of things you wanted me to answer, so I will do now. First of all, there was mention of the survey, the opinion survey that we got, the stats about people feeling unsafe after dark, when it's dark, sorry. So just to clarify, that survey is carried out every 2 years in the whole of Bournemouth, but because Boscombe is a priority, we run that survey every year in Boscombe, and we ask more people in Boscombe than we do in other areas of the town. So again, I haven't got the exact figure on me at the moment, but it's over 500 people in Boscombe who are asked those questions every single year. And so we got that result about people not feeling safe after dark. I mean, to be honest, there are many people who would never feel safe when it's dark, wherever they lived. But nonetheless, we were not happy with those results. And as a result of that, we're working even more closely with the police, with other partners, at what we can do about that. But we don't just look at those figures and say, that's not very good. We say, that's not very good. What are we going to do about it?
I actually think it's not very good. Everybody that sat here, not one person was asked that question. Not one person here
was given
that survey. Everybody here,
somebody has received it here. 500 people is quite a small proportion. They're selected at random, but they are representative, and it would be fantastic to ask everybody those questions, but it's very costly to do surveys. So what we do is we ask enough people to give us figures that we can believe. We've also followed that survey up with some discussion groups.
Perhaps it would be a good idea in the future of whether council wishes to do various consultations and surveys if they came to the Boscombe Forum first, because
so that we've
got 500 here tonight, but you know yourself, it's normally about 100.
Yeah.
In one fell swoop, you've got a big number.
Well, those surveys are done in that particular way to make sure that we can compare them year on year. What I would say is we do always come to these forums and we do always listen to what you say, and that's taken on board as well. But if you want to have a say regularly, you can join the Bournemouth Council's e-panel. If you look on the Council's website, there's an e-panel, you can join it, and then you will be asked to complete surveys every 3 or 4 times a year on a whole range of issues. But surveys are only one way. The other thing that I just wanted to say, right at the beginning of the meeting, there were questions about who do I phone if this happens, that happens, and a lot of confusion about who's responsible. There is a single phone number in the council. It's 45119, and nearly all the things that you mentioned earlier, the I don't really want to repeat what you've talked about, but stuff you were talking about, and the graffiti, etc. 45119 is your starting point. They can either deal with it, or they'll know who should deal with it, and we can give those details to Harry, and it can go on the forum's website.
So, just had a comment. Could you just explain who you are?
Sorry. Sorry, Sue Bickler. I work for Bournemouth Council. I head of community regeneration. So I coordinate the regeneration work from a council perspective in Boston and Gloucester as well.
Is that number available 24 hours a day?
If you phone out of hours, there'll be a message about what to do. It's not staffed out of hours. Sorry? It will tell you who to ring. Obviously, if it's an emergency, it will give you the appropriate number, but it's staffed. It's only staffed during office hours. It's not an emergency service. You're best to phone in during working hours.
Can I just ask something about consultations? Just talking about Ryan Benz, someone was before this meeting mentioned that you sent out a consultation questionnaire about the new road scheme outside McDonald's and what people think of it. His comment was it's too early to be sending that out because it's not finished. I understand you mentioned in the business forum, that is there some sort of task force looking at it, or because there's been a lot of you still got the cones out and just
talk. We've got a company called Michelle Tier, a member consultant there last week. They were actually looking at this.
I don't know the answer to that, Harry. I don't know what's planned in terms of further consultation once it's finished, but I'll find out to what you about it.
And is there what is happening with the road in? Because there's a lot of people concerned, the business forum is a lot of concern about the dangers. There's been two accidents that we know about. We were given a sort of a wishy-washy answer by Carol Butler, Carol Butler, that something's going to happen. But what is the actual official line from the council? What is the story with the roads?
I don't know what the problem is. I haven't heard about those accidents. Jay, do you want to say something? I think it's something we're really best taking.
I'd like to hear and get an answer today because there's a lot of concern.
If you asked in advance, I would find out from somebody in the highways department.
Is it finished?
No, it's not quite finished yet. There was a letter in the Echo today or yesterday from the head of highways who explained this, what we're going to be doing. And one of those things is that as soon as it is finished, we'll be doing safety audit. And the person who has been leading on that project will be organising that. So that's really all I can say about it.
Okay, thank you.
Just say the very last thing I wanted to say, because earlier on in the evening there was talk about neighbourhood watchers, and Martin explained he's got members of staff Dorset-wide. We've got members of staff here in Boscombe, the two neighbourhood wardens that I'm sure a lot of you know, Dave and Amanda. They're based in Romania Lane at the moment, and they will support any group that wants to try and set up a neighbourhood watch or do anything in their area that's causing a problem. They've had a lot of success with local residence groups, so do get in touch with them if there's something you're concerned about on your patch, and they will work with you. They'll pull together all the relevant people. It's not your responsibility to know exactly who's responsible for what. We understand that's complicated, but the neighbourhood wardens will help you with that. Thank you.
I've got the lady from Citizens Advice Bureau at the back. I'm just going to give her a few minutes just to quickly explain what they do. I'd also like to point out that there's an event for IAC, All About Culture, on the 2nd of August in Churchill Gardens. And there's also a new friends group in Churchill Gardens. We were going to have the chair speak tonight, but there's a change in chairs or something, so we'll bring an update about that soon. I'd like to thank Martin Undill and Sue Bickler. I think the next meeting we'll have an update from the councillors, and we'll take questions from the floor. I didn't want to do it today just because I knew there'd be a lot of questions about crime. So thank you very much for coming. Thank you.
Sorry, just for the last speaker, it's a plea really. If you've got sound and growth for public health in the next forum, look at what's happened tonight. If you've got any questions, throw them to Harry before he arrives. So if you put your questions in by email, so that Sam can turn up with the stats that you want, because I'm sure you've got lots of questions about health, and he can produce the stats. So it's just a pleasure.
Thank you.
Oh, hi. I mean, this has been a very exciting meeting, I think. I don't think I've ever been to one of these before, and so many questions, and it's, as I say, it's really exciting for me to be here and listen to all this. I am here to tell you a little bit about Citizens Advice Bureau, and basically to see, hopefully, that some of you may want to come here and volunteer with us. It's our 75th birthday this year. We've been in Bournemouth for 75 years. We're part of an umbrella organisation in the whole of the UK called Citizens Advice, and we're one of the bureaus. We have two sites, one at the Town Hall and one in Kinston at Kinston Library. We do some outreach services as well. I think one of them is here, and the other is in Westbourne and somewhere else, I can't remember. All of the things that we do are controlled really by the main organisation, Citizens Advice, and they set some aims for us and some principles for us. Our aims are what we try and achieve. We can't always do that. I mean, we aim to give advice and help for the people who need it. Now, sometimes we can't help, but we try and do that. We see, I think last year we saw over 9,000 people. And some of that work we do relates to benefits. And we help people to claim benefits. And in fact, we claimed the benefits that we achieved for people last year was something like, I've got it over here somewhere. More than, I think, £80,000 was to spend in this area. We deal with employment inquiries, relationships, legal things, anything that you can imagine, we try and help people with. And we get some funny things. I think at one time we had someone ring up and say, could we tell them how to become a monk? And of course, we think, well, we've never had this question before, what do we do? We ended up saying, well, then you should go to your local church. But there are many more questions that are very, very serious. I've been with Citizens Advice now for nearly 8 years. When I retired, I volunteered with them. And I know when I first started, I had two cases where there was some domestic abuse and I had to try and get people into a hostel, a refuge. And I've never done that before. I was a volunteer, but you know, when we're volunteers, we always have supervisors and people who can help us to help other people. We have a fantastic website, and I don't know, it's open to the public, you can look at it. I don't know if any of you have looked at it. You have, it contains, I think, everything you can possibly imagine. And it's called citizensadvice.org.uk, and you can look up anything that you like. We have some principles. The principles are things we have to achieve. We're free. We're not going to charge you anything to come to us. We're confidential. We have a very, very secure recording system which is encrypted with our own name, so that no one can access this. We are non-judgmental. We're always, we listen to you. We are on your side and we try and help you. And we're independent. Although the council give us our funding, most of our funding, We are totally independent of them. We can criticise them, and we do. We also get funding from other people, and we try and raise that funding, money. And we recently got funding from the Treasury to provide pension service, and we have 7 pension-wise guiders now, and we cover the whole of Dorset into East Devon and the Isle of Wight and parts of Hampshire. And they travel to see people because the Treasurer said no one should come to us for pension-wise if they have to travel more than half an hour. So you see that we have to travel to them. Now, most of our work is done by volunteers. These people give up their time. They're very valuable to us. We get students from the university, we get retired people, we get people who may want full-time employment, and they come to us because that will stand them in good stead when they do go for employment, and they say, well, I work for Citizens Advice Bureau, and therefore that means I can talk to people. So I'm here really to say, if any of you would like to volunteer with us, then do get in touch with us. You can come into any of our sites and say, I'm really interested. You can look at our website and this will tell you what to do. But we're there for people of the area. We give advice via the telephone. Now, you've been complaining about the 101 and you have to wait. We, in fact, we're not very good at with our phone service. We only answer about 30% of the calls that come to us. And that's because we're short of volunteers. We have 8, in our bureau, we have 8 phones that we can man. Not all day, because with volunteers, they can't work from 9 to 9 at night. We're only open from 10 until 3:30. But sometimes, like today, we may have 2 people on the phones.
If we can
that'll be really, really good. We want you. So, I mean, I don't want to take any more of your time. You know where we are, and we would welcome anyone to come and see us and see if this is something that they would like to do.
Can I just add, it's a top-notch training programme. I've been on it, and it's very, very good. It's very, very well supported. They're really good.
I mean, there is training, but you're never alone in that training. There's always someone around.
Okay. Thank you so much. If you want to volunteer and get the training, then you can go and visit them. I just wanted to end on one upbeat note. We sometimes say that we're a bit negative, but we're not. We just obviously can't fit in all the good news stories. There's lots of good stuff going on in Boscombe, and I just wanted to hear from Rick here.
I'm Rick. I work for Youth Service. Harry's asked me just to take back an event we did in May Harter and in Boston. We took our young people into the centre and we did a random act of kindness day. So we went around, they were all dressed up in their t-shirts, they're giving out rollies with positive notices. Some of the girls bought flowers, gave out flowers to people. We had some guys working volunteering in some of the local charity shop as well. So successful that our young people have ordered us into doing another event, which I believe is on the 4th of August. So if you're in town, you're walking around on the 4th of August, doing random acts of kindness for people in town. So our young people are trying to be positive and do things like that. Just one other quick thing, we do have an event on the Churchill Gardens next Thursday. I've got some information, so if you want to come around it for me, then that'd be brilliant. Thank you.
Thank you, sorry to keep you. This is all about the Boscombe Through a Lens calendar competition, which we did last year, we're doing it again this year. Any sort of exciting images of Boscombe, seafront, market day, any kind of streets, people, landscapes, or close-ups are really welcome. Prize of £100 of High Street vouchers for the best one, and the winning image featured in the 2016 calendar. So if anybody would like to enter that competition, it's on flickr.com, but I think probably you can contact the regeneration office
or look at hornmouth.gov.uk/Boscombe calendar and you can enter. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jane. I'd say thank you to Martin Underhill for taking some time to come, and thank you to Matt Shutter.
Wanted to say to everybody, because we've had a number of people get in touch with us about the old schoolhouse. So there's the three rooms that are left from the BCCA, and asking us as a forum to put it forward to nominate it as an asset of community value. So we did that 23rd of April, and we waited the 8 weeks, which was the 18th of June. We didn't hear back from the council, and so we contacted them, and unfortunately our application had gone missing. So we put forward another application, and they got back to us and said, actually, we've changed the form, and this isn't correct, and there's various things. So we're putting forward a form now, and just to let everybody update, so it's now a good news story, really, that it's going forward. Hopefully the council will be able to rush it through, because they've lost the first one. So it's not that we've forgotten about it, it's just simply that there's a bit of an admin slip up. Okay? So I'll go look to Jane now.
Thank you. Thank you everyone for coming. I'll see everyone in September. We've got the we'll be discussing health, and we'll discuss some local issues with the council. Thank you everyone, and have a good night. Good summer.